Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this year's Corden Lecture. My name is David Dixon, and I'm head of the Department of Economics here at the University of Melbourne. I would like to begin the evening in the customary way by acknowledging the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, the traditional owners of the land on which tonight's lecture takes place. The Corden Lecture Series started in 2003, so tonight is the 15th Corden Lecture. This lecture forms part of a wider programme of public lectures which are free and open to all. We welcome members of the public to sign up online and to attend these public lectures or to receive the videos once they are released. I'm very pleased to see so many people here tonight, and I extend a warm welcome not only to guests in this lecture theatre, but also to guests from around the world who will watch the online vodcast in the coming weeks. The Corden Lecture Series is named after Professor Max Corden, who is one of Australia's most distinguished economists, and I'm delighted that Max is here with us this evening. Max has contributed much to the field of economics, not only through his research, but also through his long and extensive teaching career, during which Max has shaped the thinking of many of today's great economists. The Department of Economics, the faculty, and the university are honoured that Max continues his long association with us, which began at undergraduate level quite a few years ago. It is my pleasure to welcome Professor Max Corden, who will introduce tonight's speaker. Max.
Good evening. Oh, wait a minute. Make sure I've got this. Can you hear me? At the back? You sure? Okay. Well, I must make a confession first before I talk. For 15 times, I have introduced a speaker. But last year, we had a very charming former student of mine from Ireland, and I waffled along advance in my introduction. I noticed that when I looked at the recording of it, see? So this time I've decided we've got an absolutely brilliant speaker and I mustn't take any time from him, and therefore I plan to speak for 5 minutes. And therefore I've written out what I'm going to say. Well, let me say, at current trends, India will soon have the largest population of any country in the world. At the moment, it has 98%, I checked it, 98% of the Chinese population, but the rate of population growth in India is higher, and very soon it will be the highest in the world. For that reason and others, India is surely a very important country. But there is still a long road in search of real prosperity ahead for the people of India. And this requires policies to change. Now that, what I've just said, is the theme of a new book by our speaker today. And the new book is called India's Long Road, The Search for Prosperity. This book, published by Oxford University Press, will be available shortly in Australia. And I've asked Vijay to talk about some of the issues in that book. I have read it, and quite honestly, it is brilliant. And I can only say, here in Australia, we're almost obsessed by China and everything to do with China. I think we should also be obsessed about studying India. Now, let me quote the remarks about this book of a former governor of the Central Bank of India. "Truly extraordinary. A comprehensive and in-depth survey of India's long-term potential and what needs to be done to achieve it." And I have another comment. from the chairman of the Indian Finance Commission, a tour de force, perhaps the best book in a decade on India's economic future. And nobody's paid me to say these things. This is the honest belief. Now, a few words about Vijay Joshi himself. Where is he, by the way? Oh, there he is, yes. Vijay Joshi is Reader Emeritus in Economics at Oxford and a Fellow of Merton College. Now, those of you who haven't been to Oxford may not realise that what counts in Oxford is colleges. And it happens that this Merton College, which has been his base as long as he's been in Oxford, is a beautiful place, memorable. If you, once you've been there, you'll, every other built architectural feature and garden can't equal it. It's a wonderful place. So if you do go to Oxford, do remember to go to Merton College. Now, he has jointly authored two books on the economy of India. He has been a special advisor to the governor of the Central Bank of India and has been a consultant to the World Bank and other organizations, as well as authored many articles in the area of international development economics. Now, something personal. Many, many years ago, I'm not going to tell you how many, many years ago, I came to Oxford with responsibility, among other things, of running a weekly seminar for Oxford graduate students of international economics. Vijay became my staunch collaborator for 9 years in running this seminar. And if I told you how many years ago it is, I mean, it's just, I feel quite sad, you know, that I can think about that past. Now, here's an interesting thing about him, because I remember the vividly. He was 15 years younger than me then. And amazingly, he still is. You'll see in a minute. It brings back memories. Well, the only other thing I want to add is, we've had a lot of very interesting people giving these lectures, and four of them were Martin Wolf, the famous journalist, Financial Times, John Martin from the OECD, Francis Rouen, the one who spoke on St. Patrick's Day, and Paul Collier. And all of those, and possibly some others I haven't thought of, four of those speakers had been our students in those wonderful days when you were 15 years older than me. So I take me great pleasure to introduce Vijay to talk about India and its long road.
Thank you to the University of Melbourne for inviting me. I'm honored to give this lecture in the presence of Max. Just a few words about Max. He is, of course, famous as an economist of the first rank who has made outstanding contributions to international economics. For example, in topics like effective protection and Dutch disease and economics of monetary union. But I won't say anything more about that because all that is quite well known. But I would like to say a couple of things which may not be that well known to an Australian audience. When Max came to Oxford in 1966, he brought an immense change. Graduate seminars in Oxford in those days were very strange. They consisted of a desultory conversation between a couple of academics wearing suits, sitting in armchairs, and some students in front of them talking respectfully. Max changed all that completely. He brought shirt sleeves Australian informality combined, but very important, combined with German super efficiency. And Max would be a very active participant. He would clear up confusions, dispel any lack of clarity by going to the board and draw his famous simple diagrams. So, as any former student of his will tell you, Max was a truly great teacher. The second thing I want to say about him is that he was also immensely helpful to junior faculty. Now, I was a beneficiary of this because when I came to Oxford, I just started when Max came, and I tried to write my first academic paper, and I sent it to Harry Johnson, who was the big name in, you know, one of the outstanding economists at that time in international economics. And I got a, I got a one-line reply which said something along the lines of, your paper has a very good bibliography, and it contains a major analytical mistake, full stop. And I was utterly devastated. And I seriously thought that I would begin to think of quitting academic economics very soon after I had already started. Remember, in Oxford in those days, you got jobs entirely on the basis of promise, with no achievement whatever. So that I was one of those who had nothing really to his credit other than promise. I went to Max, and Max pacified me, worked very hard with me, told me how to improve that paper and make it publishable, and indeed it was published. And that's a story that other people will tell you as well. So this is something that may not be so widely known. So if there are people here, young economists here, my advice to them is, if you have any confusions in your mind, go to Max. You will come away with him having asked you very uncomfortable and penetrating questions, but you will come away with your mind cleared and cleaned of various cobwebs that were there before. So, that's what I could go on, but about Max, but time is pressing, so. I will come to the topic of my lecture, except to mention, just say one thing. I have to talk about India, which, as he said, is a country of more than 10 to the power of 9 people in a short time. And there's only so much one can say. Most of you will know the story, which is very relevant here. of President Harry Truman, who was asked about his economists. And he said, you know, they all say on the one hand and on the other hand, give me a one-handed economist. So I'm going to be a one-handed economist. If you want nuance and qualification, you can read my book. But today I'm going to talk in a very simple way. So I'm going to address two questions. Firstly, now let me see if PowerPoint works. Yes, it does. Yeah, someone once said, I'm not going to use PowerPoint because power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. That's how I feel about PowerPoint, and I've hardly ever used it, but here we are. This is working. So two questions. How has India done so far? So a resume of India's 70-year career since independence. And the second, what should India do to become a prosperous country within the next 25 years, which is a reasonable ambition. By prosperous, I mean in the lower quartile of high-income countries, not as prosperous as Australia or the United States, but as prosperous as Chile or Hungary or Greece or Portugal. In the next 25 years. That's an ambitious but achievable project. So how to do that? So these are my two. So India's career, the resume of India's career. First of all, on the political front, India's achievements have been fairly remarkable. It was a country which many people thought at the start of independence, many people thought would break up, including, by the way, Winston Churchill, who said his famous remark, India is a purely geographical expression. It is no more a united country than the equator. You know, I mean, a wonderful remark, but I hope he's turning in his grave, because India has maintained national unity in the face of many threats, external and internal. It has it introduced democracy right at the start. There was a universal franchise from the very beginning, and it has been preserved. The democracy has been preserved, despite some imperfections in its working. There has been a lot of social progress. The caste hierarchies have been diluted. And all in all, it is hard to think of many poor countries that have been democracies that have done so well on the political front. On the economic front, you can divide the 70-year period into two contrasting halves. In the first half, the performance was pretty bad. Growth was slow. 3.5% doesn't seem slow to advanced countries now, but it was slow at that time, even relative to the developing countries. And it was certainly very slow in relation to India's needs. So it's a period of slow growth. And second half, after some reform and liberalization, you had faster growth. The first period, it was 3.5% per annum. And in the second period, it was more than 6% per annum. And why was that? Well, in the first period, you had slow growth, 3.5% a year, despite the fact that there was a doubling of the... So 3.5% a year in each decade, in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, despite a doubling of the investment ratio from 10% to 20% of GDP. So what does that tell you? If investment doubles but the growth rate refuses to budge, it tells you that the reason is low productivity. And the low productivity was because of pervasive controls on economic activity, including those on foreign trade, because India was followed under the inspiration came from Soviet models. It followed a strategy of in which the state intervened in practically everything, in all aspects of business, entry, exit, expansion, credit, employment, foreign trade, you name it. So the state there were controls on all these things. And in addition, of course, there was extensive nationalization and public ownership. And the result was massive inefficiency, which you can see which I'll show you a table soon, which you can see there was a rise in the capital output ratio, and if you measure it in terms of total factor productivity, there was a fall in total factor productivity. The second period, there was reform, at first hesitant in the 1980s, more business friendly than market friendly. But that was combined with fiscal overexpansionary fiscal policies, which led to a crisis in 1991. There was an IMF loan and all the usual stuff, and then a more decisive reform after the crisis, and which consisted mainly of liberalization of trade, investment, finance, investment licensing was scrapped, import controls was scrapped, tariffs were slashed, and so on. And the consequences were dramatic. The consequences were that productivity rose much more rapidly. Business became... Indian business showed that it had the dynamism that was required. It had just been repressed. And that all and the dynamism came to the surface, and corporate saving and investment and private saving and investment generally increased very rapidly, particularly in the 2000s, and growth took off. And you can see that in you can see that in if you do the usual sort of decomposition of growth that economists do, you'll see the difference between the two periods, and note particularly that in the second period you have is this going to work? Hang on. There's faster capital accumulation, but much, much faster growth in total factor productivity. So that just summarizes what I was saying. What about poverty, which is, if you like, the other criterion on which you might judge economic policy, growth and poverty reduction. And on poverty reduction in the first period, in the slow growth period, there was no fall in the poverty ratio. Poverty ratio remained roughly constant at about 50% of the population. By poverty, I mean dire poverty. I mean extreme poverty. The absolute number of people, population was growing, so the constant poverty ratio means that the absolute number of poor people or people in extreme poverty rose sharply from 200 million to 330 million over that period. And then in the fast growth period, the poverty ratio has fallen quite dramatically from 50% in 1980 to 22%. And the number of people in poverty first rose because though the ratio was falling, population growth was overtaking it. And so the number of people in poverty at one point in about 2000, at the beginning of the 2000s, rose to 400 million, but is now down to 270. So it is hard to think, it's quite an impressive record for a poor country, which is also a democracy. And to have had for the last three decades or more 6% growth and an impressive reduction in poverty. And here are the poverty figures that I was talking about summarized. I've just said it, so I don't need to elaborate. Even so, India now is, because of all this growth, the GDP in India is now the third largest in the world in terms of purchasing power parity, ninth largest in the world in terms of current exchange rates. So India is clearly, has done well, is growing rapidly, though there has been a faltering in recently. Is very likely to become a much more important country, as Max said, like China. One of the big questions is the economy, world economy, going to be able to accommodate not one giant, China, but two giants, China and India? But anyway, its global influence is clearly going to rise, both politically and in trade. Nevertheless, even so, though India is the third largest country by size of GDP, it is still one of the poorest in terms of per capita GDP, per capita income. So its rank is 148 out of 2013. It still has 20% of the population, which is about 250 million people, in extreme poverty, below $1.25 a day at 2005 prices, and about two-thirds of people who are not in extreme poverty but are very poor, below about $2 a day on the same metric. Social indicators are still literacy, infant mortality, etc., are improving but still well behind China. And some social indicators, for example, child nutrition, coverage of immunization, coverage of sanitation facilities, India is very bad, even worse than many low-income sub-Saharan African countries. And the quality of primary education and healthcare is truly atrocious. I'll come to that shortly. So India has a long, long way to go. In addition, growth has faltered since 2012, partly because of a debt hangover, but also due to a slowdown in productivity growth, because reform, which took place, was partial, it was incomplete, and its effects are petering out. So the resilience of growth, of rapid growth, is in doubt. Let me just show you if you look at this period, there are three phases. 80 to 2003, you have fast growths of nearly 6%. Then the 8 years after that, you have super fast growth, sort of of the Chinese South Korean variety, of more than of nearly 9%. But since then, there has been a growth, and by the way, that went on even after the global crisis. So it didn't. The fall off is not coincident with the global crisis. It went on for a couple of years. But since then, there's been a slowdown, which, according to the national income figures, it has slowed down to 6% a year. But a lot of economists, including me, do not believe the new national income figures, and for various reasons which I won't go into. But it's more likely that the economy in the last 5 years has been growing at 5% a year, which is really quite slow for what India wants to be at. So the aim is for India would have to grow at 7 to 9% a year, or 6 to 8% per capita, if it wants to reach the income level of a high-income country in the next 25 years. In other words, the magnitude of this project is quite extraordinary, or quite large. And the reason I say it is this: I don't know how many of you have seen this remarkable paper by Lant Pritchett and Larry Summers in the National Bureau. It's very easily available. It's one of the National Bureau papers. What that paper does is look at growth from 1950 onwards for 60 years in all countries for which data is available. And what it finds is quite interesting. It finds that there is a tremendous tendency for regression to the mean. By the mean, I mean the mean world growth rate. Countries grow very rapidly, can have very rapid growth spurts, short spurts, but then they fall back. They can't keep it up. There are only three countries which have kept it up to the tune of having growth rates in that region of 6% to 8% per capita growth for three decades on the run. There are only three countries which have done that: China, South Korea, and Taiwan. Now, and some others have done almost as well, but not quite, e.g. Singapore. Now, the question is, can a democratic India do a China or a South Korea as far as growth and inclusive growth is concerned? Now, of course, India sets itself naturally in the 21st century with a slightly more difficult, an even more difficult task, because it would want the growth not merely to be rapid and inclusive and stable, but also sustainable environmentally, which is not something that was achieved in China, but it has now become a major issue. So this is the ambition, and what one can say about that ambition is that India has both huge opportunities and huge challenges. Now, I'm going to, talk about the huge challenges in a second. Mostly, my talk will be about the cup that is half empty, not the cup that is half full, but Nevertheless, let me begin by, first of all, what are these huge opportunities? Well, any such vision has, you have to have some kind of a model in your mind. And the model in my mind is that emerging countries can have very rapid growth because of something called the latecomer advantage. The latecomer advantage is, forgive me if this is all known to many of you, but the latecomer advantage is as follows. countries grow because growth comes from increases in the labor force, in increases in capital, i.e. capital accumulation or investment, and it comes from what economists call total factor productivity, which is the jargon for the efficiency with which these resources are used. Now, typically in advanced countries, this thing, TFP, or overall efficiency, grows very slowly. And it grows very slowly because they are at the frontier of technology. They are, this TFP comes from expansions in that frontier. And that proceeds at a very slow pace. And therefore, you don't find advanced countries growing at more than 2 or 3% a year. emerging countries, potentially, are quite different because they don't have to invent new things. The technologies are already there. They have to imitate, copy the technologies that already exist. And that kind of growth can proceed much faster because you're just moving up to the frontier. You're not trying to advance the frontier. And the second point is this TFP has a narrow meaning and a broad meaning. The narrow meaning is about technology. The broad meaning is about all the other things that can increase the efficiency of factor use. And what are all these other things? Well, there are so many of them, it's impossible. The point is the economy has to function well, the government has to function well, institutions have to be built and function well. And there are many, many distortions in the economy. They have to be ironed out. All that can speed up the growth, if it's done, can speed up the growth rate, in addition, of course, to the copying of technology that I talked about. So if you put the two things together, you can have very rapid growth. Now, the things that development economists have talked about, for example, Arthur Lewis talked about unlimited development with unlimited supplies of labor. His point was that you have to move, there's a dualism, you have to move labor from low productivity occupations to high productivity occupations. Well, that's actually an increase in TFP. It's the same total labor force, but its productivity has increased because labor has been moved from low productivity to high productivity occupations. That's the rise in TFP. Making use of international trade, which Marx has written so much about. If you are an autarkic country, but then begin to make use of international trade, it gives you a rise in TFP. So all these things can give an emerging country the potential for very rapid growth. Now, of course, you need political stability. You need various other things. It's certainly not easy. To do all these things is certainly not easy. But, but India has the opportunity to do that. I say that the list of needed reforms is very long. So what is the theme? I think Winston Churchill, who I criticized earlier, once sent the dessert back when he was dining at the Ritz in London, saying, "This pudding lacks a theme." So everything has to have a theme. And the theme here is that many of these reforms consist of putting right the balance between the state, the market, and the private sector. India, in my judgment, is still recovering from a bad case of old-fashioned socialism, a fond belief in the benefits of extensive state ownership of the means of production and extensive micro-intervention by the state in the economy. It has to complete the move. It has begun, but it has to complete the move to becoming a modern social democracy, which means to retain egalitarian values, retain the values of liberal democracy, but move away from extensive state ownership and make much greater use of the market mechanism, with the state performing a regulatory function. This is all well known in countries which are currently advanced, but that is roughly the map that where India has to go. And therefore, I say India needs less of the state and more of the state. Needs less of the state, because the state is overextended and over-interventionist in areas outside its comparative advantage, which tells us that deeper liberalization is necessary. But it also needs more of the state, in that the state does not perform competently the core functions that are part of its proper domain, and therefore reform of the state is necessary. Now, what I'm going to do, the terrain is so vast that I've listed there six examples of what I have been talking about. That is, either there's a defective state-market relationship, or how am I doing for time? I'm doing very badly for time. 15 minutes. I'm sorry? 15 minutes. Wow, sorry. I'm doing very badly. What?
Keep going.
I'm doing very badly for time. I've listed six items there, which sort of fall in the rubric that I've been talking about. I'll clearly not have time to talk about them. Indeed, I don't know how many of them I can talk about, but let me make a start. So, and there are many things I'm not going to talk about. There they all are. We take the first item. The first item is that this is an example where a defective state market relationship. India has price controls on many key commodities: food, fertilizers, fuels, electricity, water, rail travel, to mention a few. Now, prices are controlled, consumers buy these things cheaply, prices are below costs of production, therefore producers have to be given subsidies. The subsidies are given either out of the budget directly, or they are implicit, because the state enterprises that produce these goods make losses or low profits. So, these subsidies have very damaging effects. They have damaging effects on efficiency, because they discourage production and investment in these commodities, because the producer price is low despite the subsidy. They encourage wasteful use of the commodity. They damage income distribution, because the object of doing all these, giving all these subsidies, is to benefit the poor. It's an instrument of income redistribution, but it's a highly inefficient instrument of income redistribution, because the subsidies, it's a price subsidy, so subsidies available to everybody. So actually, the subsidies are highly regressive. Most of the benefit goes to the rich, because they consume vastly more of these commodities than the poor. It does not much good for income distribution, and it damages the fiscal position, because the burden of these subsidies is very large. It means that the state cannot do many other government expenditure on many other desirable activities is curtailed, and the burden of these subsidies is about 6% of GDP, which is a massive amount. Now, I could tell you exactly how it works in food, fuels, fertilizers, etc., but I have no time to do that. I'll just mention water, because Australia is also short of water. India is short of water, but water in many places is free. So it's unpriced or it is sold at a very cheaply. So that's just one example of it obviously has bad effects for the kind that I've talked about. But what would reform consist of? Radical reform would consist of winding up the subsidies so that everyone pays market prices. Winding up the subsidies would create fiscal space to begin with at 6% of GDP, which is huge. And then out of that, you compensate the poor by direct income transfers. Not the fiscal space created is so large that you could not merely compensate the poor for the elimination of subsidies, you could give them a basic income supplement which brings them up from their average income to the poverty line. even bringing the poor up, all the 250 million of them, to the poverty line from where they are average, would cost less than 1% of GDP. And we can liberate 6% of GDP by eliminating subsidies. And then I have and if we do that, there's a threefold benefit, because you have improved the living conditions of the poor, you have improved efficiency of resource allocation, and that will increase growth. Money has been liberated for public investment in infrastructure and various other desirable things, and that will increase growth too. So there is a three-way gain from doing this. And in fact, one could, because the money liberated is so large that I personally, the problem with what I've just said, there is one problem. The problem is, how do you identify the poor? It's very hard to identify the poor. The means testing is impossible. Everyone cheats. Everyone wants to pretend they're poor. So that's a big problem. How do you actually pay the subsidy? Well, one answer to that, and the one that I advocate in the book, is that you have a universal basic income supplement. You give that subsidy, you give that cash transfer, which would compensate the poor for subsidy elimination and bring them up to the poverty line. You give that to everyone. That cuts through the identification problem. Not merely does it cut through the identification problem, it also makes it politically easier to to get rid of the subsidies, because everyone's getting something. Of course, that something is a flat sum, and therefore is proportionately, progressively less as you get, for people on richer, higher incomes, which is as it should be. But it's like a lump sum subsidy. And affordable, because it would only cost 3.5% of GDP, all in my book. You have liberated 6% of GDP. In fact, you could liberate more if you did various obvious things. I mean, India has only 4% of India's voting population pays income tax, which is absolutely scandalous. But so if you increase that percentage, if you taxed incomes in agriculture, which are totally untaxed at the moment, if you got rid of some unproductive tax exemptions, I mean, you could liberate 10% of GDP if you did all the sensible things. And this costs, universal basic income supplement costs 3.5% of GDP. So it's doable. There are objections, of course. People say it will destroy the incentive to work. Well, I think as microeconomists will tell you, if you give a lump sum subsidy, the substitution effect against work is zero. And the income effect against work is very small at such a miserable level of income. I mean, if you're giving, the subsidy is actually will be about $60 per person per year. I mean, that's not going to destroy the incentive to work. And there are many other, there are various objections. People will blow it on drink and gambling, but all the evidence gathered by randomized control trials of giving people money shows they don't do that. They spend it on sensible things. Of course, doing this is not easy. Doing this has various problems, political and otherwise, but that is what a radical reform would consist of. Now, I don't know how I'm doing for time. Again, I'm probably running out of time. I have 5 minutes? Okay. Well, I would have told you about the bias against employment. India has a huge employment problem. The employment problem is not what we think of as the employment problem in advanced countries. It's not open unemployment, because everyone has to work in order to survive. Only the educated unemployed are openly unemployed, because they might be supported by their families. The unemployment problem is that there is that 86% of the labor force is crammed into the low productivity informal sector. And the employment problem is, why doesn't the modern high productivity employment sector employ more people? That is the employment problem. And there are many things required to solve that problem, which I go into in detail in my book. But one of the important things is labor laws, which in India are fierce. It is impossible in India to the simple rearrangement of tasks within a company. You have to give workers three weeks' notice. If you want to close down a firm, you have to take government permission if you employ more than 100 workers. So all the sum total of all that is that labor laws are so inflexible that no one wants to employ people. Employers want to stay away from, and therefore the tendency is to have capital-intensive, skill-intensive industry, which is what India has been moving towards. But unfortunately, I mean, we all know about India's IT industry doing extremely well, but employs very few people, maybe 2 or 3 million people. But we have not merely do we have a huge backlog of underemployment, but we have 10 million, we have Australia being added to our labor force every 2 years for the next 30 years. So India has a huge employment problem. So you need many different things to be done, including labor laws. Well, I've obviously totally underestimated. What I want to say now is something about the reform of the state, because it's all very well to talk about the state having to get out of things and get out of the way of business, but there's much more to it than that. The state has actually got to do things, and the state does the things, some of the things that it is supposed to do very badly. And one of the things that it is truly alarming is the state of Indian primary education. It is truly atrocious. I mean, you may be impressed by the Indian students that you see here, but they constitute a minuscule proportion of educated people in India. We are talking about the millions of children who are educated in primary schools, and and what is going on there is shocking, because you have absenteeism rate among school teachers of 25%. Teachers don't turn up, and when they do, while away the time doing something else. They can't be fired, because teachers' unions are extremely strong and politically very powerful. It is that sort of problem that the state has to tackle and is not tackling. And I don't think that India's growth, I think India will run into a very serious human capital constraint unless it tackles its atrocious education sector. So that is the bad news on that. And there are many other things, including the corruption, the bad state of the core services like the police, the judiciary, the regulation. I mean, if you have liberalization, that's fine. But with liberalization comes the need, the necessity of having independent regulation. Well, e.g. in the electricity sector, you need railways, you need regulators. The regulators mustn't be supine people who are in the pockets of politicians, they must be independent. All this, total factor productivity is not just about technology, it's about all these things. So the message that I will now end up with, what should India do? It has to reform, and the unifying theme is more of the market and more of the state. And of course, I have to say that the economics has limitations. Economics can't tell you how to conduct reform in the context of a democracy. That's what politicians are for. There is a need for leaders who can motivate, communicate. And there's one particular problem that, again, economics can't tell you how to do, but is very important, which I've just been talking about, the principal agent problem, how to get state functionaries to do their jobs. So it's not just a question of monetary incentives, it's a question of how to get them to internalize the mission of serving the public interest. That sounds vague, but is very important. And there's no simple answer to that. That's why I have this picture here of two of India's prime ministers, both crying, because they're crying because it's all so difficult. At the top, you've got Manmohan Singh crying, and at the bottom, you've got Narendra Modi crying. But I will end up, I would have talked more about all this. I would have said something about the Modi government, which is currently in power. I would describe its performance as reasonably good on macro stability, passable but underwhelming on all the things that on the state market stuff that I've been talking about, and poor on the reform of the state. And India's future is, I think, full of opportunity. I don't think there's any doubt that India is going to become a major country. But if you ask me a narrower question, is India going to do a China or a South Korea in the next 30 years? My patriotic heart leaps up to say yes. But my analytical head says it is doubtful. Thank you.
Well, thank you, BJ, for a very wide-ranging talk. And there was a lot of material to cover, and you didn't quite cover it all. So it's an opportunity to give the book a bit of a plug and say that the questions that weren't answered, you can find the answers by buying a copy of the book.
Yes, here it is.
So we have time for a very small number of questions. We have a couple of roving microphones, so if you have a question, raise your hand and we'll bring a mic. So, gentleman over here.
Thank you very much for the talk. My question is, India has quite a big diaspora globally. What influence do you think the diaspora can bring to India?
Well, India's diaspora has done quite a lot in terms of, especially in the IT industry. But compared with China, India's diaspora is, the performance of the Indian diaspora is mediocre, I would say. Because if you think about the Chinese diaspora, I mean, they have come back and invested massively in China. And in the sectors which I was talking about, where you need to create employment. I mean, you have the Chinese diaspora coming in with money, setting up large factories which employ large numbers of people, producing shoes and toys, and of course China is now growing out of that, but that's how China made an impact, and textiles and apparel, clothing. Now, the Indian diaspora doesn't do that. The Indian diaspora sends remittances back, which is, of course, nice. Their remittances are quite an important part of India's balance of payments. And they come back and start startups, IT firms, So there is they bring back, if you like, technology and know-how. And these are all very good things. But I think that I would regard their performance, if I'm judging the performance, as subpar compared to the Chinese.
Professor, I'd like to thank you for a very good lecture. I'd like to refer to two inefficiencies in India that you haven't had time to cover, and to ask you whether there's any future. The first one is the law, one of the most inefficient in the world. 10 years for a decision to come out of the courts. The second one is one thing that India leads the world in, that is bureaucracy. The most perfect people of stopping anything happen anywhere in the world. Now, this they got from the British, I think, but I wonder whether there's any chance of changing either of them.
Well, I mean, the two things you pointed out were, of course, I would have talked about them if I'd had the time. They are very much part of what I meant when I said reform of the state. I mean, India needs not just the state getting out of the way of the market, it also needs the state to do the things that it should be doing. And one of the things it has to do is to have a efficient and clean judiciary, which at the moment does not have. You're absolutely right. The backlog of cases in India is, I think, 30 million. Of which 25% have been unresolved for 5 years, and 10% have been unresolved for 10 years. That is perfectly true. So that is a serious problem, but it's not the only one. I mean, the Indian police force is a serious problem. Indian bureaucracy in India is, it's not that there are too many, it's wrong to think that India, that the state sector in India employs too many people. That's not true. It's understaffed and over-bureaucratized. India employs fewer police and fewer judges per head of population than almost any country. But it is over-bureaucratized. There are too many procedures. If I showed you how many, do you mind if I just, I know the time's running out, but so here's India's rank in ease of doing business among 100. This is the World Bank's ease of doing business survey. So I haven't listed, it should be another column here, which is the number of procedures you have to undertake. To do anything. This I only thing I've got is the time taken in days. Well, you see how long it takes to start a business, to get a construction permit, etc. I mean, that's because of over-bureaucratization. Now, the Modi government has a saying all the right things. It is trying to make it easier to do business. Its ambition is to get India's rank. From the overall rank was, I think, 130. It has some target of bringing the rank from 130 to 50 in the next 5 years or something like that. But so there are things being done, but I think it is as big a problem in India. The reform of the state is as big a problem in India as the relationship between the state and the market, which is what most economists talk about.
I'm going to draw questions to a close there. Vijay, thank you very much for coming to speak to us tonight. I have a small gift for you as a token of our appreciation.
Thank you very much.